James chapter 5, and our topic is the prayer of faith and mutual confession. The prayer of faith and mutual confession. And I'll read the whole chapter. Our text is going to be 15 and following. Go to now, you rich men, weep and howl for your miseries that shall come upon you. Your riches are corrupted and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver is cankered, and the rest of them shall be a witness against you, and shall eat your flesh as it were fire. You have heaped treasure together for the last days. Behold, the hire of the laborers who have reaped down your fields, which is of you kept back by fraud, crieth, and the cries of them that have reaped are entered into the ears of the Lord of Sabaoth. You have lived in pleasure on the earth and been wanton. You have nourished your hearts as in the day of slaughter. You have condemned and killed the just, and he doth not resist you. Be patient, therefore, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. Behold, the husbandman waited for the precious fruit of the earth, and hath long patience for it, until he receive the early and latter rain. Be ye also patient. Stablish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord draweth nigh. Grudge not one against another, brethren, lest ye be condemned. Behold, the judge standeth before the door. Take, my brethren, the prophets who have spoken in the name of the Lord for an example of suffering, affliction, and of patience. Behold, we count them happy which endure. You have heard of the patience of Job, and have seen the end of the Lord, that the Lord is very pitiful and of tender mercy. But above all things, my brethren, swear not, neither by heaven nor by the earth, neither by any other oath. Let your yea be yea and your nay nay, lest ye fall into condemnation. Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. Is any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church, and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. And here's our text, 15 and 16. And the prayer of faith shall save the sick, and the Lord shall raise him up. And if he had committed sins, they shall be forgiven him. Confess your faults one to another, and pray one for another, that ye may be healed. The effectual, fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Elias is a man subject to like passions as we are, and he prayed earnestly that it might not rain, and it rained not on the earth by the space of 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth brought forth her fruit. Brethren, if any of you do err from the truth, and one convert him, let him know that he which converteth a sinner from the error of his way shall save a soul from death, and shall hide a multitude of sins. Last week, we considered prayer for the sick by the elders of the church. Verse 14. Today, we continue with verse 15 and following, which discusses the results that follow prayers for the sick. Verse 15 reads, and the prayer of the faith shall save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up, and if he has committed any sins, he will be forgiven. Note that healing here is not attributed to the oil, which is merely a sign or a symbol, but to prayer. The prayer of faith. The symbol or ceremonial may strengthen faith, but it can never be a substitute for true faith. That is why sacramentalism is so evil. The standing or perpetual means of grace for healing is Christian prayer, while the oil is an arbitrary rite suited to the Jewish Christians in a time of transition. And there are a number of things to note about verse 15. First, and this is quite obvious, what does James mean by the prayer of faith? It is a prayer that flows from biblical faith or is made in faith. The faith is that of the one who prays. It is a prayer which expresses trust in God. It reveals a belief in God's ability to heal the sick. In prayer, the elders depend fully on the Lord who can grant the healing. They offer their prayers in faith because they have many passages in Scripture which tell us of God's love and mercy toward his people and as many healings of the saints in both the Old and New Testaments. Yes, there's special healings or special miracles, but there's also just prayer and regular healings. A study of Scripture indicates that not only does the one praying need to have faith, but also the one being prayed over. Both need to have faith. And there are a number of passages where unbelief in the sick hindered our Lord's working of miracles. Here's a few. Mark 6, 5 to 6. Now he could do no mighty works there except that he laid his hands on a few sick people and healed them, and he marveled because of their unbelief. Christ was amazed at the unbelief of the Jews. And yet he should be amazed. I mean, he was doing all these miracles in Israel, and they still didn't believe. The description of Jesus as not being able to work miracles is Christologically striking. It does not mean that Jesus lacked the power to heal in himself. He had that power. But that he did not heal in situations of rank unbelief. In the presence of gross unbelief, Jesus restricted his activity to the healing of a few sick individuals. That's it. The Jews, at least outwardly, were God's people. Outwardly. But without faith, it is impossible to please God. Faith is the instrument which lays hold of Christ and God's promises. Unbelief robs people of the great blessings of God. If you want blessing, you have to have faith. Unbelief in Christ and the Word of God is so irrational and stupid that it made Jesus marvel at it in astonishment. He was amazed at their unbelief. Now, regarding the prayer of faith, here's what Matthew Henry says, and it's wonderful. Quote, prayer over the sick must proceed from and be accompanied with a lively faith. There must be faith both in the person praying and in the person prayed for. In a time of sickness, it is not the cold and formal prayer that is effectual, but the prayer of faith. Now, I was raised in a Roman Catholic church, and people on their deathbed, they call for the priest, and the priest comes there, and he's got a little book with prayers written in Latin, and he mumbles the Latin over the people. No prayer of faith, it's just pure ritual. And then he anoints the person with oil and so forth. Nonsense. The prayer of faith is what is needed. Now, it is important to keep in mind that prayer does not heal. Only God can heal. Prayer is instrumental. So if we talk about the power of prayer, it's God who has the power. Prayer merely apprehends or is the hand that reaches out and asks God to work. Prayer must spring from our knowledge and belief in Scripture and God's promises. It clings to a hearty confidence in God's power and love given to us through Christ and His Spirit. This appeal to the prayer of faith is not vain repetition or prayer as a magical formula. That's sacramentalism, that's externalism, that's ritualism. The priest mumbles Latin over the person. He could be daydreaming, he could be thinking about the Super Bowl, but they believe that things work automatically without faith. Even in the apostolic era, when miracles were in their full force, the miracle is always attributed to faith. In Matthew 9:22, Jesus said, "Thy faith hath made thee whole." Now, Christ did not say, "Touching my garment made thee whole," but your faith. In Mark 6:56, we read, "As many as touched his garment were made whole." Jesus instructed her that the rite or the physical act was not the agent or the means, but her faith. It alone grasps the blessing. In Acts 3:16, we read, "And his name, through faith in his name, has made this man strong." In all of our living, duties, spiritual acts, and obedience to God's word, we must keep in mind the necessity of a true, living, vibrant faith. And this is especially true of prayer, where we come to God as naked beggars, as sinners saved by grace. Faith is the fountain of prayer, and prayer should be nothing else but faith exercised. We come to Christ through faith. We recognize Jesus' merits through faith. We worship God through faith. We obey God's law through faith in Christ. If you want to strengthen your faith, the best method is to diligently study your Bible and get to know Christ better and the true and living God better every day. The more you know Christ, the more you know God, the more you know God's word, the more your faith will be strengthened. Now, while we're on the topic of faith, we need to note the distinction between the faith essential for justification and faith for healing. In principle, undoubtedly, all true faith is one and the same. Faith is faith. It's belief. It's trust. It's belief. It is always trust or belief. But in the object and operations of faith, there are diversities, which it is useful to understand. Justifying faith is that act of the soul by which a person lays hold on Christ and has peace with God. Its special object is the atonement for sin, which Jesus made on the cross, the person and work of Christ, Jesus' person, his sacrificial death, his perfect life, his righteousness that is reckoned to the sinner. Faith lays hold of Christ. It is the instrument which lays hold of Christ's perfect redemption. This faith spoken of in the passage in James is a more general grace, the fruit and companion of justifying faith, but still not to be confused with it. It is rather a general confidence in God's power, wisdom, and goodness toward believers. And its special objects are the promises, the word, and the character of God in Christ. See, if faith is faith, but there's differences in objects of faith. This distinction is important on our day, for the Federal Vision heretics confuse the faith that lays hold of Christ with the fruits that flow forth from faith. We need to make a distinction. In sanctification, we do need to trust in Christ's sacrificial death and glorious resurrection. Paul makes that clear in Galatians 5, Romans chapter 6 and 7 and 8, and other places. Indeed, as Paul says, Christ is our sanctification, 1 Corinthians. But we must not confuse the work of the Spirit in us that flows from the efficacy of Jesus' death and resurrection, and justification, which is a declaration of righteousness in God's heavenly court, which occurs objectively to the sinner in the heavenly court. It's objective. It's once for all. It doesn't take place inside of you. It takes place outside of you. To believe God for healing is to trust God for a sovereign work in us due to Christ's grace, mercy, and mediation. Yes, the power comes from God. The power comes from Christ. Christ is the mediator. It's his efficacy. But healing takes place in us. Justification takes place outside of us. Good works are something we do. They're not objective to the sinner. Speaking of the Federal Vision heresy. And then second, James notes the result of the prayer of faith. And the Lord will raise him up. God will make the sick person well. This promise raises some important questions. Now, given the apparent universal, unconditional terms of this promise, is James teaching us that the prayer of faith always leads to healing 100% of the time? Now, I bring this up because that's the teaching of Kenneth Hagin and Kenneth Copeland and Joyce Myers and all these people. Well, if you say it and you really mean it, God has to do it 100% of the time. Well, the answer is clearly no, that's not true. It's not 100% of the time. Last week we noted that even the apostles, who without question were men of great faith, did not have their prayers answered 100% of the time. In church history, when great men of God were sick like George Gillespie and had hundreds of godly men and women praying for them, they were not always healed. And in fact, George Gillespie died at the age of 35 from tuberculosis. Are we to suppose that none of those who prayed for him, which included Samuel Rutherford, Douglas, Bailey, Guthrie, etc., did not have faith in God's ability to heal? Are we to suppose that? That these men were all of poor faith? And the answer is no. The explanation given to such a seeming unconditional universal promise is that the broader context of Scripture gives us a condition which is this: insofar as it is God's will. And this is the importance of hermeneutics and understanding whenever you look at a passage, there's the immediate context. There's the context of the book in which it was written. There's the immediate context. There's the context of the chapter or paragraph it's in. And then there's the context of the whole book. And then there's the context of the whole Word of God. If you take a passage out of context, then you'll get into all sorts of problems. That's how we get Arminianism and all sorts of things. The Christian familiar with Scripture knows this, and therefore obvious scriptural conditions do not always need to be spelled out in immediate context. We find other seemingly universal unconditional promises that we know from other sections of Scripture are not precisely universal. Note, for example, Jesus' promise in Mark 16:18. They shall lay hands on the sick and they will recover. Well, this is generally true, but as we noted, Paul could not heal Epaphroditus or Timothy. He couldn't do it. We find a promise very similar to James in Mark 11:24. This is a favorite proof text to Kenneth Hagin and Kenneth Copeland, and I used to listen to a sermon by Kenneth Hagin on this passage in the 70s. Listen to what it says. I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you receive them and you will have them. When we ask, we are, as James says in 1:6, to believe and not doubt. But we must ask for things that are not sinful, that's obvious. And we must ask in accordance with the will of God. We can always pray with a full confidence in God's healing power and love. But for reasons known only to God, sometimes the sick are permitted to die. God does not always answer our prayers. Now, 10 years ago, we had somebody in this church who died of cancer. And believe me, there were hundreds of people praying for this guy. And the elders went and met with him, prayed over his bed and all that. And he was not healed. Does that mean that everybody out of those hundreds of people that prayed for him, none of them had true faith? Absolutely not. Knowing the broad context of Scripture, we could say that the prayer of faith is always answered in a sense. Either by the bestowal of the specific object asked for or by the gift of something that God knows is better. There were Christians that died in the Twin Towers on 9/11, but they went right to heaven. They went right into the arms of Christ. The unbelievers did not. And then third, another result of prayer is named the forgiveness of sins. 15c. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. This third part of verse 15 recognizes the fact that at times sickness is a result of God's chastisement for sin. The reference here then seems to be not sin in general, although all sins are certainly forgiven, but rather to something serious, special, or scandalous, which has resulted in God sending disease as an affliction. I say that this because there's nothing more clearly taught in Scripture than our complete depravity. And thus John says, 1 John 1:8, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. And we're taught by Jesus Christ in Matthew chapter 6 to pray every single day for forgiveness. If God made us sick on account of sin in general, we would be sick all the time, every day, the rest of our lives. Therefore, it makes sense to view the sickness here to be some high-handed, serious sin that has brought chastisement. Note, for example, here's Revelation 2:20-23. Nevertheless, I have a few things against you because you allow that woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, to teach and seduce my servants to commit sexual immorality and eat things sacrificed to idols. And I gave her time to repent of her sexual immorality, and she did not repent. Indeed, I will cast her into a sick bed, and those who commit adultery with her into great tribulation, unless they repent of their deeds. I will kill her children with death, and all the churches shall know that I am he who searches the minds and hearts, and I will give to each one of you according to your works. Well, we keep this in mind. Note that the Bible does teach that if there had been no sin in the world, there'd be no disease or suffering. Sickness, disease, suffering, aging, and death all are a result of the fall. the idea, which has been taught by full preterists, that death and disease was natural to God's created order, is a heresy, and it's really kind of blasphemous, the idea that God would create a world with evil in it. Suffering and disease are part of the curse. Thus, Jesus' healings of disease during his ministry pointed to his ability to forgive sin. Remember, when Jesus healed diseases and when the apostles had these sign gifts, the purpose of healing diseases wasn't so people could go, wow, that's great. Now I've got 10 more years, I can go to the beach and have fun. No, the purpose of the healing of diseases was to point to Christ's divinity and his ability to forgive sin. We may remember the paralytic let down through the roof to be healed by Jesus. They actually had to cut a hole in the roof. Our Lord sensed his guilt for sin, and he said this, "Son of, be of good cheer. Your sins are forgiven you." It's Matthew 9:2. And then after sensing the wicked thoughts of the scribes, he said, "Who can forgive sins but God alone?" And that's a true statement. Who can forgive sins but God alone? They didn't know Jesus was God. Jesus said this, "That you may know that the Son of Man has power on earth to forgive sins." Then he said to the paralytic, "Arise, take up your bed and go to your house." Matthew 9:6. A cure without pardon of sins is of very little use because you're simply cured to go sin some more instead of serving God. Disease is the leaf, while sin is the root. Thus Jesus said to the healed man from the pool of Bethsaida, "See," and this is after he'd been healed and then he met Jesus teaching in the temple, "See, you have been made well. Sin no more, lest the worst thing come upon you." John 5:14. That God wants us to see a connection between salvation from sin and healing is especially clear in Isaiah 53. Now, this passage is, of course, speaking of forgiveness of sins, but it's also used by people like Peter, and it's applied to physical healings. The prophet Isaiah said of Christ, and this is Thomas Manton. Thomas Manton is really good on this. The prophet Isaiah saith of Christ, Isaiah 53:4, "He hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows." The meaning is the punishment of our sins. So St. Peter applieth it, 1 Peter 2:24. "He bare our sins in his own body on the tree," which is the express meaning reading of the Septuagint. But now Matthew applied it to Christ's cure of sicknesses, Matthew 8:17, "That it might be fulfilled which was spoken of by Isaiah the prophet. He took our infirmities and bare our sicknesses." How shall we reconcile these places? I answer thus. In taking away sickness, which is the effect, Christ would represent taking away sin, which is the cause. Christ's act in taking away sickness was but a type of taking away sin. Now Matthew applied that to the sign, which did more properly agree to the truth itself or thing signified. For you may observe, for the clearing of this and other scriptures, that is the patriarchs and their actions and in what they did were types of Christ. So Christ's own actions were in a manner types of what he himself would do more principally. As casting out of devils signified the spiritual dispossession of Satan. And therefore, there happened so many possessions in Christ's time, so the curing of blindness, the giving of spiritual sight, and the taking away of sickness, the pardoning of sins. Well then, if sin be the cause of sickness, if we would preserve or recover health, let us avoid sin. Exodus 15:26. "If thou wilt hearken unto me, I will bring none of these diseases upon thee," etc. Okay, sicknesses and diseases were a curse for breaking the covenant. "Otherwise you may, as that woman, spend your whole estate upon the physicians and yet the cause continue." You will see Deuteronomy 28:21-22, sin is threatened with a consumption, fever, inflammation. Usually the disease answereth the sin. The distempered heats of lust are punished by an inflammation. Asa put the prophet in the stocks and he himself was diseased in his feet. 2 Chronicles 16:9 with verse 12. There are times when God did more visibly plague disobedience, as in the times of the law, when dispensations were more corporeal. Diseases were a part of God's coercive discipline. However, now and then, God useth the like dispensations. In other words, he still does it today. Maybe not as much, but he still does it. Sinners are met with according to the kind of their offense, though many, I confess, are left to be taken out by their own rust. And like chimneys, they are left alone so long till at length they be fired. I think he's talking about creosote, lighting on fire. But how many adulterers have we seen going up and down like walking spittles? He's talking about venereal diseases and their effects. How many beastly epicures whose skins have been set afire by their own riot and surgudry, whatever that means, etc. End of quote. So the application of 15C is important and obvious. If we are struck by a serious illness, we ought to examine our spiritual life to make sure we are not guilty of some unrepented sin. With David, we want to pray. This is Psalm 139, 23, 24. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxieties, and see if there is any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. The Bible teaches that if we want to be forgiven, we must repent and confess. Therefore, James' statement in 15c presupposes that the sufferer has repented and thus is assured of forgiveness. If we are sick, we must search our hearts and seek pardon first. David says, Psalm 103, 2-3, bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits, who forgives all your iniquities, who heals all your diseases. And here's what Matthew Henry says. When you are sick and in pain, it is most common to pray and cry, oh, give me ease. Oh, restore me to health. But your prayer should rather and chiefly be, oh, that God would pardon my sins. End of quote. If sickness drives you to meet with God in a time of lukewarmness and declension, then we should thank God for sicknesses in such a situation. And that brings us to verse 16, which is the rest of our sermon today, this morning. Open confession and mutual prayer. And I'll read 16 through 20. Confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another, that you may be healed. The effective fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. And then the rest of this we'll look at, Lord willing, next week. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed earnestly that it would not rain, and it did not rain on the land for 3.5 years, 3 years and 6 months, a divided seven, which is used over and over in Scripture for a period of tribulation. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth produced its fruit. Brethren, if anyone among you wanders from the truth, and someone turns him back, let him know that he who turns a sinner from the error of his way will save a soul from death and cover a multitude of sins. Now, James' discussion of prayer for the sick, healing, and the forgiveness of sins naturally leads into a discussion of mutual confession and the effectiveness of prayer. The minority text has, therefore, connecting this to the previous verse, the majority text in the King James Version does not. But nevertheless, there is a connection. The connecting idea is something like this. Brethren, I have noted that when believers are ill, they need to summon the elders of the church so that prayers will result in healing and spiritual comfort. Note, however, that not only must the elders pray, but all the members of the church can pray and assist their brothers. So what James does is he moves from a specific case of a sick individual to a general pattern of prayer, each for one another. Confession of sin and praying for one another are vital ingredients for health in the Christian community. And this section is quite easy to preach on. It has three essential verbs that make our study easy to follow. First, there is a requirement to confess. Confess your trespasses one to another. Or to one another. Confession, which involves a willingness to acknowledge sins and ask for forgiveness, is crucial to the Christian community. Unconfessed sin blocks the pathway of prayer toward God and blocks the path of reconciliation between Christians. When we sin, we must specifically confess that sin to God. That's quite obvious. When we sin against our fellow brother in Christ, we must confess that sin to him in order to achieve reconciliation and have peace in the church. We confess and ask them for forgiveness. Confession is a sign of repentance and a plea for forgiveness on the part of the sinner. A person who refuses to confess reveals a stubbornness and obstinacy. And this causes discord, conflict, and schism in the Christian community. There is a clear connection in Scripture between confession and forgiveness. Proverbs 28:13 says this, "He that confesseth and forsaketh his sin shall find mercy." So you got some guy and he's in the mafia and he's killing people and he goes to the Roman Catholic Church and he goes to confession. He's wasting his time. You got to forsake your sin and confess together. The Lord's Prayer is also clear. Matthew 6:12. "Father, forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us." In Leviticus 5:5, we read about what a believer must do when he realizes he is guilty of sin. "And it shall be when he is guilty of any of these matters that he shall confess that he has sinned in that thing." And it goes on to talk about making atonement. In Numbers 5:6-7, we read, "When a man or woman commits any sin that men commit in unfaithfulness against the Lord, and that person is guilty, then he shall confess the sin which he has committed. He shall make restitution for his trespass in full, plus one-fifth of it." Okay, the context is sinning against someone, a brother. "And give it to the one he has wronged." So we see that confession and restitution, when appropriate, are fruits of genuine repentance. If you really repent, you confess. You acknowledge your sin. And if you need to make restitution, you make restitution. David in a psalm of repentance said, here's Psalm 32:5. "I acknowledged my sin to you, and my iniquity I have not hidden. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the iniquity of my sin." He admitted it. He laid it out in the open before God. He confessed it to the Lord, and God forgave him. And then also Psalm 51:2-4, another penitential psalm. "Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I acknowledge my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done evil in your sight." Acknowledgement. Lays it out in the open. Admits it to God. Repents and confesses. In confession, we've come first to an agreement with the Word of God and the moral law about our behavior. Okay, why do we study the law of God? Why do we study the moral precepts? Why do we study Christian ethics? So we know when we're doing something wrong, and the Holy Spirit uses that to convict us of sin. If you don't know the Word of God, if you don't know the law of God, then you can expect to be antinomian. And we live in an age of great antinomianism among professing Christians because people hate the law of God and they don't study it at all. The Holy Spirit illuminates our mind to understand God's truth and then apply it to our own behavior. It is for this reason that a study of the law of God and Christian ethics is so important for sanctification. R.J. Rushdoony used to say, well, the law of God was given, one of the purposes of the law of God, I'm paraphrasing obviously, is for our sanctification. And all these Reformed people, oh, he's teaching salvation by works. They don't know what they're talking about. Once you're saved by Christ, how do you know how to behave? Well, the law of God is your standard for sanctification. Then after having identified sin, we humble ourselves and we acknowledge it before God. This is an open and honest acknowledgement of guilt. I did it. This is what the law says. This is what the Bible says. And I did this, which is a violation of your word. I am guilty. This is the content of confession. Lord, I'm guilty. We note that in the law, confession is connected to blood atonement and, when necessary, restitution. If we have sinned against another Christian, we must humble ourselves, confess it to him, make restitution when appropriate, and ask for forgiveness. So what James is basically just expositing the Old Testament. This is how we progress in sanctification and keep the peace and fellowship in the Christian community. A refusal to acknowledge sin and confess is connected in Scripture to pride, unbelief, obstinacy, and apostasy. And you'll meet people like that. They're just totally unwilling to admit they've done anything wrong when it's crystal clear they have. And I fear for those kind of people's soul. They're not willing to repent. They're not willing to confess. They're not willing to admit their guilt. They're not willing to acknowledge their sin before God. And that's important that we do. And what's really good on this topic, of course, is Jay Adams and his books on counseling. He's right up front. Look, the church is made up of a bunch of sinners who sin. So we better learn how to obey this and do this, because we're going to need this teaching, because we are a bunch of sinners. A person who does not do this shows an unwillingness to repent. He is clearly in rebellion against God. And then Thomas Manton, he notes confession's importance for personal sanctification. The best way to bring the soul into a dislike of sin. Confession is the best way to bring the soul into a dislike of sin. Confession is an act of mortification. It is, as it were, the vomit of the soul. It breedeth a dislike of the sweetest morsels when they are cast up in loathsome ejections. Sin is sweet in commission, but bitter in the remembrance. God's children find their hatred is never more keen and exasperated against sin than in confessing. Well then, come and open your case to God without guile of spirit, and then you may sue out for pardon. David maketh an argument of his confidence. This is Psalm 51:3. Blot out my offenses, for I acknowledge my transgression. Confession doth not offer a bill of indictment to God's justice, but a sad complaint to God's pity and compassion. Oh, set upon this duty. It is irksome to the flesh, but salutary and healthy to the spirit. Guilt is shy of God's presence. The Lord is dreadful to wounded consciences. Ah, but consider, this is the only way to sue out for pardon. Gracious souls would not have pardon, but in God's way. Lord, give me repentance. And then give me pardon. End of quote. Give me repentance. Give me pardon. Make me miserable like David when I sin, until I confess it to you. Till I repent and confess. Till I repent and acknowledge my sin. Confession of sin to God is the essence of true repentance. A man who refuses to acknowledge his iniquity before God does not truly see or acknowledge the sinfulness of sin, or the true holiness of God. Only when we agree with Scripture, reject human autonomy, and bow before the divine word can we enjoy peace with God. 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And then second, we are to confess to each other. That is, we must confess our sins to those whom we have offended or wronged. This does not mean that we are to confess to a priest, which is a heresy of Romanism. Now, the practice of strict Roman Catholics, a super fanatical Roman Catholic goes to confession in the old days. I don't know if they still do this. Roman Catholic churches used to be open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And you could go have confession anytime you wanted. And the really hardcore Roman Catholics who worship the Virgin Mary and idols and so forth, they'd go to confession every day. But the serious Roman Catholics would go to confession every Saturday. And so when you went to church on Sunday, you could take the host with a clear conscience. And that's the way I was raised. We'd go to confession every single Saturday. So, but this does not mean confession to a priest, which is a heresy of Romanism. It also does not mean that every sin is to be confessed before the whole church. James does not specify the church of the elders. Rather, he speaks of mutual confession on a one-to-one basis within the circle of believers. You've sinned against Bob. You need to go to Bob and confess it to Bob. That's what he's talking about. Now, there's a place for broader confession in the church, before the whole session in the church, but this is only in cases of public or very scandalous sins. For example, I was in a church and a guy had sex with a babysitter or something and got her pregnant and had a child out of wedlock. He had to confess before the whole, that's the scandalous public sin. He had to confess it before the whole church before he could take communion. Or sins that go to the third step of Matthew 18, the Matthew 18 process, in other words, unrepented sin goes before the whole church. First step, second step, third step. Once it goes to the session and the person tells the session to pound sand or lies to the session, then it goes to the whole church, but not before that. So James is talking about one-on-one sins. Passages such as Matthew 18, 15 and following make it clear that sins between individual believers are to be dealt with privately. And Calvin has a really good section on this in his commentary. He talks about it's within. If you sin against two people, you confess to two people. If you sin against three people, you confess to three people. If you sin publicly in front of everybody, you confess it to everybody. But it's to be kept private. There are those that believe that Jesus is speaking of confession in the community meetings. And that was the view that I was taught when I was a Pentecostal. But such a view ignores the broad context of Scripture. For example, Matthew 18. I went to charismatic churches and they'd have these sessions where the whole church would get together and everybody would be encouraged to stand up and talk about every sin they committed that week. And it resulted in a lot of gossip and it resulted to people kind of skipping out of church because they didn't want to do that. It was very counterproductive. Leads to gossip and people not attending. Very counterproductive. There is such a thing as a body of believers making corporate confession to God for corporate sins and declensions. But that is not the focus here either. If you look at the old Presbyterianism in the days when it was much more spiritual, much more reformed, much better than it is now, it was common for presbyteries and synods to have corporate confession of sins. Okay. We hired college professors that violate the covenants and are malignants. We have seminary professors that celebrate Christmas. No, they don't do that anymore. Now they excuse sin and they persecute those who point out sin. James clearly has in mind false sins, trespasses, or injuries done to a brother. To go to a brother and admit an offense when a brother legitimately has something against us is one of the plainest duties of Christian ethics. The Bible could not be more clear about this. Now, it's not practiced much today, but it's one of the clearest duties of Christian ethics. Jesus said, Matthew 5, 23 to 24, if you bring your gift to the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go your way. First, be reconciled to your brother and then come and offer your gift. Our Lord tells us that a professing Christian who is unwilling to do this is in a condition in which his worship is unacceptable to God. That's pretty serious. Jehovah will accept no worship or service from your hands until you have confessed your sins one to another. It is a great fault of character, rooted in pride and rebellion, that is unwilling to admit an offense. It requires humility and a willingness to put that person and the Church of Christ over one's ego. We have seen that much of this epistle is concerned with teaching believers to get along and have genuine unity. That's one of the main things here. Thus, we have said a lot about the evil use of the tongue and grumbling against one another. Here we have the positive side of the equation. Not only must you restrain your tongue and not speak evil through gossip, slander, backbiting, and such, not only must you stop grumbling, murmuring, and complaining about what you do not like about others in the church, you must also have a positive ministry of reconciliation. So that pattern, that put-on pattern of sanctification we find in the law of God and in Paul, very explicitly in Paul, we find in James. You are not to badmouth others. Instead, you are to have a ministry of reconciliation. You are to focus on improving yourself, on getting rid of your own faults, on self-examination, on confessing your own sins to others you have offended. And this is really a brilliant strategy for corporate sanctification. Others first, me second. I'm talking about priorities. Christ and his church first, me second. Loving my brother first, loving myself second. That's what the Bible teaches. Instead of disturbing the peace of the church through gossip and murmuring, we are to be aggressive with our love and are to be active peacemakers. Instead of being egotistical, self-centered, and thus murmuring against others, we should do everything we can to make the situation right. We are to nurture love and peace by an attitude of reconciliation. This means active communication, not clamming up, and rejecting Christian fellowship. You see, well, why is there so many problems in the church? Why do we have so many things of schisms today? Well, people don't obey this. People don't obey Matthew 18. People don't obey Leviticus about loving our neighbor. In that context, there is the Jew. Of going to them and working things out. Instead, people clam up and they get all angry inside and they lash out and they gossip. But what if someone is offended over something that is not defined as a sin in Scripture? And that does happen. Well, there are people who are thin-skinned and easily offended. There are people who are unnecessarily sensitive and judgmental. You still have a moral obligation to go to them and communicate in a manner for the purpose of achieving reconciliation. This is especially important with married couples. The wife's offended. Husband doesn't think he did anything wrong. Maybe he didn't do anything wrong. He still has to go to her and say, "Hey, I'm sorry I offended you," and work it out. One does not have to admit to sin when there is no sin. That would be a stimulus to a Pharisaical legalism and would encourage an unlawful censorious spirit. Nevertheless, one can still apologize for a miscommunication or an unintended offense. For example, "I am sorry that I offended you. That was not my intent. I did not mean that. I meant this," etc. And this is this principle. Jay Adams goes into great detail about this in his counseling books, where a husband does something. It's not a sin, but he offends his wife, and you want to make peace. Well, you don't have to admit you committed sin, but you can still work things out. Remember, also the one who is offended is obligated to seek reconciliation and peace through confession. The one who offended is obligated to seek reconciliation and peace through confession. And the one who is offended is obligated to go to that person and seek reconciliation through biblical admonition. You got Matthew 8, you got Matthew 5, 9, you got Matthew 5:18. And Jay Adams talks about how ideally they should meet each other on the way to each other's house. Both parties are equally responsible to make sure a full reconciliation takes place. And both parties must forgive and forget once reconciliation is achieved. Okay, you don't go, well, and this happens all the time in churches. I've seen this over and over the past 25 years. People, they go through the process, and outward, "Oh, I forgive you, everything's fine now," they shake hands. And then they don't let it go. The person who supposedly has forgiven doesn't let it go. That's wicked. That's wicked. And Jesus threatens those people. If you're not willing to forgive, the Lord's Prayer, forgive me as I've forgiven my brother. If you do not truly forgive and put it behind you, then you should not come to the Lord's Supper. If you habitually refuse to forgive and forget, then you very likely are not even a Christian. I've met people like that in churches. They're totally unforgiving of anything. They make lists. I've known people, they make lists. You did this 5 years ago. You did this 10 years ago. Here's a list. This is what you said at the picnic. When I was in the RPCNA, this couple tried to get me fired. This is 20 some years ago. And they actually had a list of everything I had done for the past couple of years that they didn't like, that they gave to Presbytery. Brian was at the picnic, and Brian said, we're going to have deer nostrils, barbecued deer nostrils. You know, I'd be joking around. They'd write that down. I mean, it's just ridiculous. You got to be forgiving. Third, biblical confession is to be accompanied by prayers for one another, and we'll have to continue this next week. Here's verse 16. And pray for one another that you may be healed. The beauty of Christian fellowship comes to expression in the practice of mutual prayer after sins have been confessed and forgiven. The offender and the offended party pray on behalf of each other. Together they find spiritual strength and comfort in the Lord. There could be no greater sign of reconciliation and fellowship than this. In their prayers, they visibly and audibly demonstrate reconciliation and fellowship. They have heard each other's sins and faults, and now they, out of love and duty, they want to do something to help a brother be a better Christian, to grow in grace and knowledge. That's what it's all about. We're here to help each other be better Christians. We're not here to have a contest who's better than one another and to condemn one another. We're here to help each other be better Christians. That's what it's all about. Both parties pray for the spiritual welfare of each other so that forgiveness and edification follow. The assumption of this command to both parties is that everyone is guilty at one time or another of sin. As Paul says, Galatians 6:2, bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. By confessing our sins, faults, trespasses, etc. to one another, we will better understand each other's weaknesses and we will be better at praying for each other. Some Christians have trouble with controlling their temper. Others tend to be irresponsible with money and things. Still others may have a tendency to gossip. Some have a problem with lust. In any case, mutual confession can lead to very specific prayers for each individual in the church. We want to help each other with specific weaknesses and tendencies to grow in grace and overcome problems, problem areas. Everybody's different. Everybody's different. Some people are very irresponsible. Well, you need to pray for that area. We're going to take up this third point next week, Lord willing, in more detail as we consider James' treatment of prayer that is powerful and effective. And then fourth, and we'll wrap it up with this. The purpose of confessing sin and praying for each other is noted next, that you may be healed. Most scholars, most commentators, whether old or new, due to the context, define healing here as broad. It refers to spiritual as well as physical healing. In fact, if anything, the focus is on spiritual healing. Here's what David said in Psalm 41:4. I said, Lord, be merciful to me. Heal my soul, for I have sinned against you. The soul is sickened by sin, like the body is weakened by disease. As disease causes pain to the body, sin will cause pain and suffering to the heart. We must avoid sin as we avoid a deadly disease. And when we do sin, we must confess it to bring healing and peace to our souls. In repentance and confession, we run to Christ the mediator, our advocate, the great physician of souls for healing. As it says in Isaiah, by his stripes we are healed. And we'll have to continue this next week. We've run out of time, but he'll go into more detail and he'll have the great example of Elijah. The effective prayer of a righteous man. Let us pray. Father, we give you thanks for this amazing book, inspired. by the Spirit, your Spirit. Oh, Lord, it convicts us. We fall short every day. Fill us with your Holy Spirit and grant these truths into our heart and mind. Cause us to focus our minds on this and convict us and help us to be more obedient to your word. Help us, Lord, to do all these things for our own edification and the peace of Zion. In Jesus' name, amen.